so good to see you in the house of the Lord today. Amen and amen. I appreciate everyone who helped make that video. That was very sweet of you. And y'all totally surprised me with that. I mean, I figured I would get a happy birthday at some point, but that was a surprise. And so thank all of you so much. Y'all mean the world to me, and it's such an honor to serve under such a great man and woman of God. And I tell you what, you can get all the best quips by hanging around Bishop Hanchy. I love the one about you. You don't look that old, but I remember when you did. That is good. I've been using that. I got it from him and been using it for quite some time. So it come back around to me today. But it's so good to see you in the house of the Lord. Tell all of our mothers, look at a mother close to you and say, Happy Mother's Day. Oh, you guys are just fantastic moms. Where would we be without them? As Pastor Stephen said, we wouldn't be nowhere. We wouldn't even be born. But even after you were born, without mom, I tell you, you'd be in bad shape. Bad shape. So we're thankful for all of our moms today. And again, thank you for all the birthday wishes and the gifts. We're going to dive straight into the Word of the Lord this morning. We're going to get started pretty quickly. I do want to let everyone know one thing, though. We're going to have a leadership meeting next Sunday afternoon at my home at 5:30. So if you're a pastor, a deacon, or if you're a ministry head over a ministry, or if you're on one of the teams and your pastor or your ministry head would like for you to be there, then you're invited. That'll be next Sunday afternoon at 5:30, and I'll let you know the details as we get a little bit further along, but we're looking forward to seeing everybody there. It's going to be a great time of fellowship and also some learning, and we're going to do that every other Sunday, give an opportunity for everybody to fellowship together and also to grow and to continue building the health of the ministries that operate Christ Church. Amen? So plan on being there with that. Now, with that being said, let's pray today. And then we're going to get straight into the Word. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for being in your presence today. Lord, we are honored that we're allowed to come and that, Lord, we stand before the Creator of heaven and earth. We stand before the one who knows all hearts, who knows our names, who knows that our name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, or that perhaps it is not yet written there and needs to be today. And Lord, we just pray for the Holy Ghost to have free reign in this house, Lord. Lord, we know your word is greatly anointed. Lord, we ask that you anoint our ears to hear it, anoint our hearts to receive it. And Father, we thank you that it's what the Holy Ghost says about the word going forth that makes a difference in people's lives. And we praise you for it today. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. And so again, great to see you in the house of the Lord. Today we're going to begin a series, a new series, that works out just perfect for Mother's Day. And the new series we're going to begin is The Power of Passion. The Power of Passion. I'll tell you, there is power, great power, locked up in people's passion. And I'll go ahead and give you a preview and just go ahead and get ahead of myself and tell you, so many people lack power in their lives today because they are lacking passion in their lives today. We'll get into that in just a bit. And so this new series is so appropriate for Mother's Day Sunday because mothers are some of the most passionate people that you're ever going to run into. And so again, happy Mother's Day to our moms, but passion is something that most people can operate in sometimes, but normal folks' passion can sometimes seem a little bit dim when it's compared to the passion of a mother concerning her family or concerning her children especially. Amen. Most mothers already know, but God wants everybody to understand that there is power in passion, and God is ready to unleash some of the power of passion to help you accomplish mighty things in your life and in the kingdom. Amen. James chapter 5 and verse 16 says, confess your faults one to another. Oh, Lord, you want to stop and preach right there. Get off your high horse. Stop acting like you've never done anything wrong. But all that's free and not even part of my notes, so we'll keep going. And confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. And my focus this morning is the effectual, fervent prayer. Say fervent. Prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And of course, that's a righteous woman as well. Fervent prayer availeth much in the kingdom of God today. Amen. Fervent prayer brings solutions to the problems that you're dealing with. Fervent prayer heals the sick. Fervent prayer brings lost and crazy sons to an altar of repentance where they might find Jesus Christ. Fervent prayer brings wayward daughters back to the house of God. And fervent prayer changes lives. Fervent prayer. Does anybody in here even know what I am talking about this morning? Has anybody ever been the recipient of some benefits from somebody who knew how to pray, and they prayed fervently? They prayed long. They just wouldn't quit. They just wouldn't leave you alone. They kept praying for you, even though you didn't even want them to be praying for you. And their fervent prayer has brought you back to a place that you thought you had turned your back on forever. You thought you had disqualified yourself from. Fervent prayer gets daddy a job this morning. Amen. Fervent prayer brings down fevers in sick children today. Amen. Fervent prayer causes kidneys to begin functioning again the right way, miraculously, when doctors said there was no hope. Amen. Fervent prayer keeps lost, crazy kids alive when they're out doing lost and crazy things. And it gets them one more opportunity to make Jesus their Savior and change their life. Amen. And so what does fervent mean? That's not a word that you use in the normal course of your day. Unless you're quoting that scripture, you probably never use that word. But I've got a definition of fervent for you this morning. It is having or displaying a passionate intensity. A passionate intensity. Tell somebody, say, you got to be passionate. Amen. Impassioned, passionate, intense, vehement, ardent, sincere, fervent, heartfelt. And I love the last three words included with the definition: hot, burning, or glowing. Burning. Is there anything burning inside of you this morning? Is there any heat or life inside of you today? Is there a glow still deep down inside in spite of all the hell you've been through, and in spite of all the problems that you still got and everything you're going to have to face tomorrow? Is there anything still burning this morning? Because I want to tell you, there is power in passion. Again, one of the reasons so many people are lacking power in their lives is because they're also lacking passion. Tell your neighbor, say, you need the power of passion. Passion produces heat. It produces a burning somewhere inside of a person. And one of the words of the definition was intensity. Intensity. Intensity refers to the measurable amount or the degree of something. Passionate intensity. What is the measurable amount of the passion in your life today? What is the intensity level? Where does it rate on a dial or a measure or a meter? What I would like to know is, are there any intense, passionate people left in the kingdom of God? Is there any passionate people at church this morning anywhere? Give God some praise if there's some passion somewhere on the inside of you this morning. And I believe today, I believe as I stand before you, I believe with all of my heart that every single one of us is in need of something from God today. We're in need of something, something for our families, something for ourselves, something for our community, something for our country that is tearing itself apart with craziness and racism and all kinds of garbage going on. Is there anything that you stand in need of this morning? And so the title of my message this morning is, How Bad Do You Want It? How bad do you want it? So many times, it is the quality or the intensity of your passion that determines the outcome of the challenges and the battles that you face in life. If you write things down, you ought to write it down. It is the quality, the intensity of your passion that will often determine the outcome of the battle that you are currently going through in your life today. The quality of your passion determines the quality of the answers that you find to life's questions. The quality of your passion determines the quality of your achievements in life. It determines the quality of your accomplishments in life. I don't care how smart you are. I don't care how many qualifications you have. I don't care how many abilities you have. If there is no drive inside of you to accomplish anything, it will all be wasted today. I don't care how blessed you are. I don't care how anointed you are. If you don't have passion to overcome a bloody nose and a knife in the back, your anointing will go for nothing, and nothing's going to be blessed in the kingdom of God. It is your passion that will determine the quality of your accomplishment. All things being equal, you can be as gifted as you want to be. You can be as blessed as anybody can make you, but without the passion and the power of passion to go straight through hell and keep on going. Oh, Winston Churchill said, if you're going through hell, don't stop. Don't stop. That's not the place to sit down and cry. That's not the place to have a pity party. That's not the place to say, nobody likes me. I think I'll go eat a worm. That is a place to stiffen your backbone, quicken your step, raise your foot a little bit higher, and keep on marching, because you'll die there if you don't get some passion on the inside of you. Amen. Tell somebody, you need some passion. There's got to be a fire. There's got to be something inside of you that will keep you going when everybody else has already quit. There's got to be something inside of you when terminal boredom has set in and you're bored with the challenge and you're bored with the routine and you're bored with everything going on. There's still got to be something on fire inside of you that won't let you quit just because everything's going okay right now. Amen. I've never seen so many people quit when they were blessed as there is in the church today. When they were going through hell, when they were addicted out of their mind, when they were struggling for the next breath, when they couldn't buy nothing, when they were bumming rides to church and bumming rides to work, and when they didn't have no hope, they kept on keeping on anyway, and they just put one foot in front. all of a sudden they come to church 2 Sundays out of a month instead of 4. And now they can drive. But now the passion has went low and the intensity has decreased. And so they've come to the place where they have set themselves up for failure. Because they failed to recognize the power that was inherent in their passion all along. Amen. Tell your neighbor, say, there's power there. Amen and amen. And so if you're not aware of anything that you need from God today, I won't hit you hard, but if you're not aware of anything that you need this morning, then it is an indictment of the lack of passion in your life today, and you have come to a dangerous place. You don't need nothing. You're rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. You don't need to grow and become better. You don't need to be a better husband or a better wife. You don't need to be a better leader or a better minister. You don't need a lost family member saved from God. You don't need a sick member of the church healed. You don't need to see young people changed and blessed and given hope. You don't need to see the next generation receive Christ. If there's nothing you need from God today, it is an indictment of the lack of passion in your life. And I worry for you today. You better get a fire on the inside of you, because you need power. And there's power in your passion. Folk today in the American church don't need anything, because there's nothing burning inside of them anymore. And some folk I have discerned have made a conscious decision not to want anything. They've made a choice. They've made an agreement with hell that I'm just not going to want or desire anything, because you are so afraid that you cannot have what you desire. You're so afraid that you can't change your family's future. You're so afraid that you can't change your own life. You're so afraid that you can't change your habits. You're so afraid that you can't make your marriage any better. And so you've made an agreement with hell and defeat and just decided that you don't want anything anymore. And your lack of passion has left you powerless. And you're just taking each day as it comes, trying to survive till the next sunrise. An old Western. My dad watched Westerns all my life. We walked around talking in the dialogue of old Westerns at my house. We'd just give a quote, somebody respond with the right one. But there was this one fella on a show, and some men with guns come out in front of him on the road, and they were talking about killing him and robbing him and taking his clothes. And he said, "Look now, I don't want no trouble. I'm just going down this here road." And there's a whole lot of Christians that are just trying to go down this here road. They, "Look now, I don't want no trouble. I'm not trying to get nobody saved. I'm not trying to bring nobody to church. I'm not trying to change a generation. I'm not trying to change the world. I'm just going down this road right here. I don't want no trouble." The fact of the matter is, though, that doesn't work. You get trouble anyway. You get trouble. There ought to be something inside of you that catches on fire when all hell stands in the road in front of you and says, "No, your whole family can't be saved and going to church at the same time." There ought to be something inside of you that rises up and says, "Yes, my family will be saved. Yes, my children will be saved. I have passion and I have prayer and passion. passionate prayer changes things. And I'm going to make a difference. Amen. Amen. And so God has sent me here this morning to preach to people who are on the verge of not caring anymore. He sent me here to talk to folk who are thinking about giving up on their marriage, thinking about giving up on their children, thinking about giving up on their college and their future, thinking about giving up on their recovery. And he sent me here to wake you up and to stir something inside of you this morning and to tell you that you've got to get a little fire of the Holy Ghost inside. You've got to generate some heat. You've got to start some life down inside of you before it's too late. Before it's too late. There is healing for your body in the house of God this morning. Amen. Somebody give God praise if you've ever been healed. Amen. There's a resurrection for your marriage in God's will this morning. There is a word for your children that will change their lives and bring them to the kingdom, bring them to their purpose, and bring them to the place of service to God that they're called to. Amen. There is deliverance for your addiction today. There's salvation for your lost, crazy husband today. Amen. There is deliverance for you. There is a spirit of power and of a sound mind. Even though you're on the verge of crazy, there is a spirit of power and a sound mind that can walk you back from the edge of wherever you've gotten to today. Amen. And so there's no doubt. There is no doubt that God has an answer. The only question is, how bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? Ask your neighbor this morning, say, how bad do you want it? Luke chapter 18, beginning with verse 1, tells a great story, one of my favorite stories. I use it when I preach often. Jesus speaking, saying, men ought always to pray and not to faint. And he says, there was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. And a widow in that city came unto him, saying, avenge me of my adversary. Handle my adversary for me. And he would not for a while. I don't know how long a while was, but it was for a while. Could have been a long time. But afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor do I regard man, yet because this widow woman troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me and wear me out. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said, and shall not God avenge his own elect? Will not God handle the adversary that his own elect has? Will God not avenge his own elect, which cry unto him day and night, though he bear long with them? It may take a while. Tell somebody, it may take a while. It may take a while, but God will avenge his very elect. Go ahead and praise him. That's all right. You can do it. And so how bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? How bad do you want victory over your adversary? How bad do you want victory over your depression? How bad do you want joy in your marriage? How bad do you want God's plan for your future, young person? How bad do you want it? And how great is your passion this morning? I want to take a moment here and I want to help you to see the difference between mature passion and immaturity. I want you to see the difference between mature passion and immaturity. I want you to see the passion that the kingdom of God requires and what passes for passion in the world. I love the fact that Jesus used a widow woman in our account of the unjust judge this morning. See, I picture her to be an older woman. At the very least, she might not have been that old, but she was a woman with experience. Are there any women with experience in the house? Is there anybody who's lived a little while in the house today? Amen. She was a woman with experience. We know that she had been married. She had experienced the wedding day. She had experienced life as a new bride. And we know that she had buried her husband, that he had died, and that now she is a widow. She was a woman who had been ripened by the experiences of life. She wasn't immature. She wasn't somebody who had never been through anything and so didn't know how to deal with nothing. She was a mature woman, and she had mature passion. See, some folk think, ladies, that you've just been beat up by life, but really, you've just been matured by the experiences that you've had. You've come to a place of maturity where you can handle the passion that it takes to see God do great things. Amen. Oh, Jesus, I wish I had time to preach to you this morning. I wish I had time to preach to you this morning. She had been through the ups and the downs of life, yet far from her passion going out, far from it burning out and her being left without a voice and left without a will and left without any determination to make life better. And instead of being at the mercy of her adversary, she said, I will arise. I will go and find the judge. And she didn't just find him one time. Oh, Jesus. I don't know. I was about to say, I don't know what's wrong with people today, but I do. I know they don't have any passion. They don't have any passion. They say, well, I filled out a job application. That's all I can do. I mean, they'll call me or they won't call me. Let me help you. Maybe you've never been taught, but that don't get it. You need some passion. You need some intensity. You need some gumption. You need to stand up and say, I won't quit and I won't stop until I get a job that will bless me and bless my family and bless my children. And if this isn't it, then I'll find another one that is. Amen. I remember the first job I got in the satellite business. I called everybody in the impact 3 times a week. Every week until I got a job. I called everybody. And the first lady that I talked to said, have you got a truck? I said, no, ma'am, I don't. But I can do whatever I need to as soon as you hire me. She said, well, have you got a ladder? Have you got a drill? Have you got all the tools that you need? I said, no, ma'am, but see yourselves it all. And as soon as you hire me, I'm going to go get it all. Amen. Well, I'm sorry, we really don't have any openings right now. The next day, yeah, hello, ma'am. This is Jason Capers in Ovid again. I was calling you back to see if you had any openings today. It was Miss Brenda. I still remember her name. The next day, good morning, Miss Brenda. How are you doing today? I hope business is going well for you guys. I sure need to know if you might have an opening today. I really am looking for a job. Well, I tell you what, I'll call you as soon as we have an opening, and I'll call you. Waited 2 days. Good morning, Miss Brenda. How are you today? I didn't hear from you yesterday. I just didn't know if maybe I missed your call, Miss Brenda. I don't have an answering machine, so I hope that I didn't miss your call. I was just calling to check. I wore Miss Brenda out. And after 3 weeks, she told her brother who owned the company, said, hire this man. Hire this man. He clogging up my phone lines. Hire him. Get him a job. Does he have the tools? No, but hire him anyway. He'll get the tools. Just hire him. As bad as he wants a job, I know he'll get the tools. There ought to be something burning on the inside of you that will not be denied, that will not lay down and say, oh, I hope for the best, come what may. There ought to be something inside you driving you. Oh, find some passion today. Amen. How bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? There's got to be something that burns hot and steady. Passion will take you places, but it is mature passion that will bring you to God and to victory. See, lots of folk, oh Jesus, lots of folk mistake the immaturity of throwing a fit for passion. Just because you're immature enough to throw a fit and to act like a horse's tail does not make you passionate. Go ahead and give God some praise. Say amen or oh me. Just because you can throw a fit about it doesn't mean that you have passion. It just means that you're immature. Amen. People mistake immaturity for passion all the time. Or they have just enough passion to get them in trouble and not enough passion to get them victory. And they got enough passion to get in the bed, but they don't have enough passion to get out of the bed and go to work and bring home a paycheck and take care of a family. They got enough passion to get them hooked up. They just don't have enough passion to keep them together when all hell's breaking loose and when everything's not as exciting as it used to be. And that is not the kind of passion that God's looking for today. He's looking for somebody with some mature passion. He's looking for somebody with passion that lasts longer than the lust, lasts longer than the excitement, lasts longer than the shiny on your new toy. Amen. God's looking for somebody with passion today. Because it takes passion to achieve things in the kingdom of God. Amen. There is power in passion. But how bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? It only takes a little passion to enroll in college. But it takes a lot of passion to complete 4 years of it. It only takes, go ahead and give God praise if you want to. It's all right. It takes mature passion to keep on keeping on. Even though you messed up one semester, you're still going to get up and dust yourself off and go back. It takes mature passion to keep going until you have a diploma in your hands. Amen. It only takes a little passion to start or begin a ministry. Yet I tell you that if you're going to be anything more than a burnout statistic, you have got to have more than the passion it took to get you started. You have to have the passion to go through hell and high water. You have to have the passion to get your hands dirty. You have to have the passion to do it by yourself if you got to. You have to have the passion to cry and love and cry some more and keep on going. Crying while you're going, but still planting seed all the way. You got to have passion that is mature to make something out of the kingdom of God. Amen. How bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? Your answer is possible today, but how bad do you want it? Your answer is possible, but what is the intensity of your passion? Your answer is possible, but what is the maturity of your passion? God says stuff you have given up on is not out of reach this morning. You just need to be stirred up on the inside. You need to be reminded of your dreams. You need to be reminded of His promises. And you need to have some life take hold somewhere inside of you. Amen. Jesus said, remember your passion. He said, remember your first love. Remember the height from which you have fallen. Remember where you used to be. Do your first works over again. Just do them with more maturity this time. Do them with more wisdom this time. But do them with the same passion, just a little bit more mature than you did it with last time. And so how bad do you want it? I ain't got time for the rest of that. But listen to me. Stop worrying about blockbuster faith some TV preacher keeps trying to tell you you've got to have in order to get somewhere. My count, there's two people in the Bible that Jesus said, great is your faith. Two people got somewhere because they had great faith. But I read a whole lot of folk who had a little bit of faith and wrapped it in some passion, and they kept on keeping on when everything was against them, and they got to where God wanted them to be. Quit trying to make something happen with a blockbuster faith that you feel like you can't attain. Take what faith you've got, wrap it up in some passion, pray, and if the rain's not coming, get on your knees and pray again. Look up, and if it's still not coming, get on your knees and pray again. He did it seven times until he saw an answer. He marched around Jericho. Joshua marched around Jericho seven times before the wall fell. How many times you been going around this mountain? You ready to quit, and God says, just keep going around the mountain, and the answer's gonna come. Amen. You got to press in and keep on pressing. Oh, my God. My God. How bad do you want it? Live music team can come. You can close your eyes this morning. Close your eyes this morning. I tell you today that Jesus Christ is in this house, and he's in this house to answer passionate prayers. Play some music, somebody. Play some music. And if you're in here today and you know that Jesus Christ is not your Savior, you know that you need forgiveness of your sins, then I want to invite you today to come. The passion inside of you has to be greater than any intimidation of any person or any devil in hell. And Jesus Christ said, come on to me, all who are burdened and heavy laden. If you're burdened down this morning and you know you need a Savior, I invite you just to lift up your hand. You will close your eyes and bow your heads in the house today. Just lift up your hand if you're burdened and heavy laden and you need a Savior today. I'll hold just a moment because Jesus is here for you. The Holy Ghost has been talking to you for a reason. God is in this place to change your future. Amen. And amen. Hallelujah. According to that, everyone says that you're saved, which is wonderful. But now I want to talk to people who want something from God today. Is there anybody in the house that stands in need of something from heaven today? I want you to be able to rise to your feet in faith and come down to the altar today. You can come down and just make an agreement with God. You can be like the widow woman, and you can say, here I am again, Lord, standing in the need of prayer. I know you haven't forgotten me, Lord, but I'm here and I need a healing. I'm here and I need a miracle. I'm here and I need a deliverance. I'm here and I need my marriage. And so the altars are open today. If you want to come down, you can have a pastor pray for you, or you can come and get along with God today. Amen. The altars are open. If you're not in the altars, pray for those who are today.